गेट पे, गेट के बाहर करवा चौथ पे बैठ गया।
अरे लगा नहीं, भूल
गया, लगा नहीं था सकता, इसलिए मैं
तेरे गिन गया था।
श्रीमती करिश्मा पत्रकार, श्री परेश शाह चेयरमैन इंटरनेशनल टैक्सेशन कमेटी, श्री गीता चौधरी वाइस चेयरमैन टैक्स डायरेक्ट टैक्सेस कमेटी, श्री नरेश अडवाणी वाइस चेयरमैन इंटरनेशनल टैक्सेशन कमेटी, डिस्ट्रिक्ट अरविंद भाई बिहार भाई, पास्ट रेसिडेंट्स ऑफ द चेंबर, अदर डिस्टिंग्विश्ड गेस्ट फ्रॉम द डिपार्टमेंट, माय कलीग्स एंड फ्रेंड्स, गुड मॉर्निंग and welcome to this conference on domestic transfer pricing. With the increase in cross-border transactions, particularly between associated enterprises, the applicability of transfer pricing provisions under the Income Tax Act gained importance. Transfer pricing regulations have been extended by Finance Act 2012 to include transactions entered into with domestic related parties or by undertaking with other undertakings of the same entity for the purpose of Section 48, Chapter 6A and Section 10AA. Domestic transfer pricing provisions are applicable from assessment year 2013-14 onwards. Further, rules relating to transfer pricing provisions and reporting form TCEB has also been amended. From financial year 2013-14, from TCEB is required to be filed through e-filing before the due date. All the compliance requirements such as transfer pricing, the documentation, accountants, reports, etc. shall equally apply to specified domestic transactions as they do for international transactions amongst associated enterprises. These amendments have impacted many businesses as the benchmark amount of specified transaction is kept at 25 crores. My colleague on the dais will explain to you in detail about the conference. As there are many non-members of the chamber, I have a privilege to introduce to you the chamber and make you known about these activities. Established in year 1926, the chamber is not for profit organization, which is mandated to disseminate knowledge in the field of taxation, corporate and allied laws, and accounting and finance. The chamber caters to the need of the professionals, both in practice as well as in industry. It has robust membership of more than 3,500 professionals comprising of advocates, chartered accountants, company secretaries and tax consultants. Chamber operates to various committees, each catering to a specific area. The committees organizes the program on various topics such as direct taxes, indirect taxes, international taxation, allied laws and corporate taxes. Knowledge sharing and dissemination is carried out through various conferences, seminars, study centers, study groups, residential refresher course and publications. Chamber also published a monthly journal titled The Chamber's Journal. The Chamber's Journal comprises of special stories which covers almost all aspects of a particular topic. Recent issue on the journal is on the subject of your interest, that is, domestic transfer pricing. The journal is well appreciated by readers and it finds place in the library across India. Chamber manages two libraries at prominent places like Aikar Bhavan and Pratyaksh Shakar Bhavan, which are widely used by the professionals. The libraries have more than 4,000 titles and are all on leading law journals and magazines. The Chamber is also active in making representations to Ministry of Finance and tax departments. In recent years, the Chamber has acted as catalyst and has contributed substantially to the development of better tax laws, administration and compliances. Above all, the member of the chamber enjoy a unique bond of fellowship and brotherhood, and it is evident in all its activities and programs. With this brief remark, I would now request the dignitaries to come forward and light the lighting of the light of the lamp and seek blessings of the Almighty. Thank you.
honorable guest, AITKP 1, Madhuri Sudhar, Lady Speaker, Karishma Chandrasekhar, Kirtan, Nadesh, Senior in the profession, ladies and gentlemen. Warm welcome to all of you on Saturday morning to this full day conference on domestic pricing. Friends, President has already informed you about the specified domestic transaction provision that they were introduced in 2012 by way of amendment of Section 92. And we have seen the number of conferences, workshops, and much has been discussed about the provisions of the law, its understanding, nuances. But we found at Chamber that not much has been said on the practical aspects of the domestic transaction, the task pricing study, and the audit report. With this thought in mind, we requested senior professionals of the Bombay City to structure this program for us so that all of us can complete the challenges which are thrown before us in a practical manner to resolve the issues of the DP study, to benchmark the transaction, and to issue the audit report as for the expectations of the industry and as for the expectations of the market. My special thanks to three professional, Mr. V.C. Patel, Mrs. Karishma Bhattacharya, and Sanjay Toria, who helped us to structure this program in a meaningful manner to consider all practical aspects of this conference. My special thanks to Madam Madhuri Sudharan, who already agreed to make her gracious presence over here and address us a keynote. In a very short notice, she has agreed to our request and we are in this situation. And as we have always in past, there is an active involvement of the tax department, and we had in past also had presence of the DIT tax pricing in almost two conferences and most of our direct tax pricing inauguration course. Friends, I am honored to introduce our guest, honorable guest, Ms. Madhuri Sudhar. She had been in the department right from 1989. She is the IRS officer of 1989 batch. For the last 13 years, she has been in Mumbai. She has been the additional comprising in charge of assessment during the initial time when the transparent provisions were introduced in 2001 for 2 years. Thereafter, she has been on and off, but within the same core area of transparency. From 2005 to 2011, she has been working as a DR before the L bench, and she has been also a CIP appeal during this small single period in 2012, and now we see her in the coordinated post, chairman, coordinated post of AIT Transparency 1. We all know how important the post is and how responsibility it carries. With these words, friends, I present Madam Madhuri for addressing us in the keynote. And before I do so, I request my president, if he decides to present memento as a mark of our respect to her. Madam,
Mr. President, 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 Vice Chair of the International Taxation Committee. Mr. Ketan Bajani, Vice Chair of the Direct Tax Committee. My friend Karishma Popat Patwe Thakur, and my dear friends in the audience. It is a matter of great pleasure and honor for me to be here with you all on this inaugural session of one day seminar on domestic transfer pricing. I really do not know what has prompted these people to invite me for this session. In fact, I asked them what makes them think I am fit to inaugurate this session. They said it is not me, it is a post I carry. So as a representative of the partner as we get transfer pricing, I will go to. I don't claim any special knowledge or any other credit to myself to entitle me to inaugurate this session. Of course, I have spent long number of years as DR in the ITAT, whether as junior AR, senior AR or CATDR. So I never occupied any special post in the department which people would consider as coveted or anything. And so I never got invited to any of these sessions. This is the first time I'm getting invited and I'm very happy about it to be here with you. As you are all aware, these provisions relating to domestic transfer pricing, they were enacted by the Finance Act 2012. Finance Act 2012, at least from the perspective of the department, was one of the major finance act which came with some far-reaching provisions, some retrospective amendments which have been widely debated, certain other provisions which came in the provisions of the act, and one of the provisions which was enacted in this was the domestic transfer pricing provisions. The so-called objective as stated in the memorandum explaining the provisions is that it seeks to bring objectivity in calculating the amount of deduction to be given to a person when they are interacting with a related party, or to bring objectivity to put in place a proper mechanism, a scientific mechanism to determine the income on which exemption may be given to an SSE. So these have been the stated objectives in enacting these domestic transfer pricing provisions. If we step back and look, in fact, when we were calculating, many times we had to look at old case laws when we were trying to argue transfer pricing cases in the initial years, because now there are more than 300-400 decisions on transfer pricing, reported decisions for ITAT. But when we started arguing the cases in the ITAT, at that time there were no decisions or nothing to give us any backing on either side. So we used to look at decisions on Section 40A or under the earlier provisions of Section 80I, 80J, 80E, where there were provisions for inter-unit transfer, etc. So we used to look at these provisions to give us some guidance. So if we look at some of those older provisions, we can see that there was always a need for these kind of provisions which will give a machinery or a mechanism to determine the amount of exemption that should be given to a person in respect of certain specified activities, or the way in which to calculate a deduction when a person is dealing with someone closely connected. For instance, if we look at the old provisions of Section 80J or 80E, they did not have any provision akin to what we have in 80IA 8 and 10 now. 80IA 8 and 10, which is treated as a base provision now for all exemption provisions, it provides specifically as to how to determine the profits when there are intra-unit dealings with the same enterprise or the enterprise dealings with somebody closely connected to it. But no such provisions were there initially when 80I, when 80J or 80E were enacted. So some innovative associates had taken a plea before the tax department and then thereafter before the courts. When there were intra-unit transfers, say for instance they had a unit which supplied raw material to the unit which was exempt under 80I or 80E. They said this is a self-to-self transaction, therefore this transaction need not be taken into account. And in the process, they claimed a deduction on the entire income of the exempt unit without reducing it to the extent of the cost of material supplied by a non-exempt unit. So they said it is a self-to-self transaction. They relied on old rulings, Kika by Premchand, or these decisions to say that a self-to-self transaction need not be taken into account. So even at that time, even in the absence of any enabling provision similar to 80IA 8 or 10, the high courts have generally held that when you have to calculate the profit of an exempt unit, then you have to take into account all these inter-unit transfer. There was always still a debate whether these transfers should be taken into account at the cost price to the SSE or at a market price, a notional market price between the two units. High Court of Bombay said it can be at the cost. High Court of Gujarat said it should be at the market price. So still the debate was there. Thereafter, we had these provisions which were enacted in 80I We have these provisions in ATI, ATIA now, where they say that when there is a transfer from one unit to another of the same enterprise, then they have to be valued at market price. So as I said, the debate was always there, and even after the High Court stepped in to say that inter-unit transfer have to be taken into account, there was always the debate whether it should be at a cost or at the market value. Then these provisions in ATI, ATIA, etc. were enacted slowly one after the other. Then we have these disputes in Section 40A, which is what we used to refer for all our TP matters initially. If you look at the various decisions on Section 40A, again these are Section 40A is again applicable only in respect of expenditure, it is not applicable in respect of income transactions. And even there the section says where in the opinion of the assessing officer it is excessive or unreasonable. So these words excessive or unreasonable was never defined in the statute. So there was always a dispute whether the opinion of the assessing officer that something is excessive or unreasonable having regard to the fair market value. Having fair market value, the term was not defined in the statute anywhere. So there were a lot of disputes on this issue. Assessing officers have been extremely innovative whenever there have been loan transactions between close family members. They have been very prompt in taking recourse to Section 40A, or we could have instances of property being rented out by one member of the family to the family firm. Assessing officers have been drawn to attack such transactions. Or we could have salary or other remuneration paid to various close family members or other connected persons for services which may or may not have been rendered. So in all these cases Section 40A has been referred to by the assessing officers and additions have been made. But most of the additions have been disputed before the court. And the one thing about these things is these are all issues primarily of facts. So not much matter travels to the High Court, things get settled at the level of ITAT. So it is very difficult to evolve a substantial question of law on these matters. So these are all matters of factual verification. So one has to be very thorough on facts, whether the RSC makes a claim or the department tries to disallow a claim. These are matters of factual verification. Then we had the Section 80IA10 which talked of more than normal profits. ATIA 10 has a two distinct classes. Subsection 8 talks of inter-unit transfer which has to be at market price, and subsection 10 talks of more than normal profits when they are dealing with an associated enterprise, or that is a closely connected, two different persons but closely connected. So the concept is different in ATIA 10 and it is different in ATIA 8. I don't know why these different concepts have been kept by the legislature, but it is like that. So there also, what is more than normal profit? Whether it should be the average profit or the lowest profit or the highest profit, there was not much clarity on all these things. So then we had similar provisions in Section 92 before Chapter 10 came, where again these problems were there. Even under the old 1922 Act, we had Section 42, where the provisions of Section 92, which were contained later, were embodied, and that was probably borrowed from the British law. So such provisions have always been there in the Income Tax Act, and disputes have always arose on these, on interpretation of these provisions. And these are all matters of fact, and the person who could bring more facts on the table to show that the case is stronger on their side, they have generally succeeded. So all this only goes to show that the present provisions on domestic transfer pricing is very much needed in the in the Income Tax Act. Maybe you will feel, as a tax person, I feel so, and that may be right also, that I cannot say I don't have the bias of a tax person. I may be carrying some bias definitely. But I feel, looking at all these aspects, that this domestic taxation provisions, the domestic transfer pricing provisions, are very much a welcome provision in the Act. Now, having said that, whether it will really solve all the problems, I do not know. That depends largely on us, both the tax department as well as the consultants and the SSC community, how we go about it and how we put ourselves to the task. These provisions are saying that they will bring about objectivity. We all know transfer pricing, all of us admit every day that transfer pricing is highly subjective. So it is trying to bring some objectivity within the subjectivity. We cannot do away with the subjectivity in the subject of transfer pricing. So subjectivity will always be there. Initially, when the SSC claims that certain transactions are at arm's length, he is using some amount of subjectivity. when the tax consultant prepares a report and comes before the department and says yes, for these reasons the transactions are at arm's length, there is subjectivity at that stage also. When the assessing officer accepts or disputes that, then also there is subjectivity. In transfer pricing, as you are all aware, all the orders passed by the transfer pricing officer have in fact approved the DA transfer pricing. So I have been a transfer pricing officer in the past. So sometimes when we seek approval from our, when we used to seek approval from our DA for the transfer pricing cases, we had to step into the shoes of the consultant. We had to say why we are accepting the arm's length price of the transaction, why we are not making an adjustment. So there again we were trying to take a subjective argument. And if we disputed the arm's length price determined by the assessee, then